we were taught by the historians and within our own traditions that when the Romans conquered Judea, a few hundred years after that the tribes of Israel went into exile, perhaps millions of Judeans were sold into slavery, into Africa, into Rome, deep into Africa. And if you look now, you're seeing people who are most likely the descendants of those slaves who kept true. I'd like to bring up a few specific examples because they're going to be game changers.
I'm looking today at the book of Romans, chapter 11, verse number 29. We read there that the gifts and the calling of God are irrevocable. Why am I sharing this with you today? Because over the years, many in the church have said that since the Jewish people rejected Jesus, they're no longer His chosen ones. But the scripture says that the gift and call of God is irrevocable. The Jewish people are still God's chosen people in a very specific and special way. In fact, Jesus' return is linked to Jewish people receiving Him as their Messiah. I want you to understand, beloved, it's important for you and I to get into agreement with God concerning His plan for the salvation of the Jewish people. As a people group, the Jewish people, the people of Israel, are still God's special inheritance.
At the time, most of the world was pagan, and the ways in which they worshiped their pagan gods were horrible, including homosexuality and murder.
Pray for peace in Jerusalem. May all who love this city prosper.
This is Robert Stearns, and we are so excited about the Day of Prayer for the Peace of Jerusalem that will be coming to you live from Jerusalem in just a few days. Tune in and join this global, worldwide prophetic prayer movement and be a part of the Day of Prayer for the Peace of Jerusalem.
In Africa, the two largest tribes in the world today are one in Afghanistan, the Pashtun, and one in Africa. You do have the Ethiopians, you do have the Lemba tribe in South Africa, who we know we had the Cohen gene, the priestly genetics, the Y chromosome, amongst almost 10% of them. We have different tribes all over, but the largest is the Igbo tribe of Nigeria, numbering 40 million people, who self-identify as being from the children of Israel. The Igbo made up a significant percentage of the transatlantic slave trade. The Igbo made up a significant percentage of the transatlantic slave trade. The Igbo made up a significant percentage of the transatlantic slave trade.
In the early 1800s, a community was established in Prince Edward County, Virginia, that consisted of freed slaves who called themselves Israelites. Richard Randolph, a former slave owner, who was also a cousin of Thomas Jefferson, documented in his will before his death in 1796 that he desired that his 90 slaves be granted their freedom and 400 acres of his land. In 1810, his widow honored his wishes, freeing the slaves and granting them 350 acres of land. The former slaves are responsible for giving the name Israel Hill to the community they established on the land, and the residents of the community called themselves Israelites.
When Paul appealed to the Romans to give to the Jews in Jerusalem, he said regarding the other churches that were giving, they were pleased to do so, and indeed they owe it to them. For if the Gentiles have shared in the Jews' spiritual blessing, they owe it to the Jews to share with them their material blessings. Now, to be clear, that is Paul speaking, not Ron.
Look how much African-American communities have suffered. You're living in poverty. Your schools are no good. You have no jobs.
You got a new prison industrial complex. Poor folk get caught, drugs on the corner. But not one executive of a Wall Street bank goes to jail.
We know about the pipeline to prison. How do we stop this thing and turn it around?
You need more police. We need law and order.
The people in our prisons have made some mistakes, and sometimes big mistakes. They are also Americans.
As a people group, the Jewish people, the people of Israel, are still God's special inheritance.
This is First African Baptist Church, the oldest black church in North America. The building built by slaves. The gentleman that laid the first brick laid the last. The balcony hold pews that actually were built by slaves. They have the oldest information in this building. That information is written in cursive Hebrew writing. That information is written in cursive Hebrew writing. That information is written in cursive Hebrew writing.
Before it was finally condemned in the U.S., it affected an estimated 65,000 Native American, African American, and disabled women who had all been forcibly sterilized. Soon after, the anti-eugenic sentiment spread worldwide and was considered a violation of human rights in almost every international body, which now say that perpetrators of this practice should be punished and the victims compensated. Fast forward to today. What would you say if I told you that eugenics is still in full effect? And even worse, that it's being administered by a first world democracy. Yep, believe it or not, the Israeli government has been forcibly administering birth control to a segment of its population. For the first time, an Israeli government official has publicly acknowledged their practice of injecting Ethiopian Jewish women against their will with contraceptives. Israel is a country that has experienced a significant influx of Ethiopian immigrants during the last two decades. Now, some 130,000 Ethiopians, most of whom are Jewish, live in the country. However, the Ethiopian minority population is heavily marginalized and segregated, not to mention they experience exponentially higher poverty and unemployment rates than that of native Israelis. In fact, there have been multiple instances of racist mobs who have vandalized and harassed Ethiopian neighborhoods. And even these nationalists are even supported by some members of the Israeli Knesset. At one nationalist rally, a Knesset minister, Miri Regev, described illegal immigrants as a, quote, cancer to the country.
I recently became friendly with a black Messianic Jew, and he was educating me on the black Hebrew Israelite movement. So I just knew that as some kind of cult that says the white man is the manifestation of Satan, and that they're the original Israelites, and Jews like you and me, we are fake Jews, etc. And this felt, but I didn't have a lot of information or history because I'm so much outside of that community. So this fellow's historian, he's well educated in these areas, and he's going through the whole history where they came from in Africa and identifying as black Jews or black Israelites. And then he said that these then began to expand it to say all blacks are the real Israelites and the whites are not. So, but it started with folks that generally had this heritage, and he'll tell me, oh yeah, this is how we pronounce this in our community, we have this tradition. But
there's a lot of trauma from the transatlantic slave trade and from what happened. It's all very fresh. So we have to be very diplomatic and sensitive about them. But there's a lot of trauma from the transatlantic slave trade and from what happened. It's all very fresh. So we have to be very diplomatic and sensitive about them. But there's a lot of trauma from the transatlantic slave trade and from what happened. It's all very fresh. So we have to be very diplomatic and sensitive about them.
השאלה הראשונה זה מי זה ישו בשבילנו, בשביל היהודים? איזה עמדה יש לו?
ישו נולד לאמא יהודיה, או בעיקרון יהודי, והנוצרים לקחו אותו כמנהיג שלהם.
אוקיי.
הם טוענים שהוא לא נולד מאמא בכלל, הוא כאילו
מאבא, כאילו אבא שלו אלוהים, כן, נכון.
אבל אנחנו יודעים שהוא נולד כן מאבא.
אוקיי. מאיפה אנחנו יודעים בעצם?
זה מובא בתלמוד הבבלי.
אוקיי, מה כתוב?
שמי התעברה. כתוב שם מי התעברה, אני לא זוכר בדיוק את השם. אם תרצה, אני...
יכול להיות יוסף, כי היה לו בעל יוסף.
אני לא זוכר ממי התעברה.
Peter Schaefer is head of the Judaic Studies at Princeton University. In his book, Jesus and the Talmud, he documents and analyzes every time Jesus is mentioned in the pages of the Talmud.
Keep in mind that the Talmud was written hundreds of years after Christ lived. And so it has references about Jesus in it, and they are hateful, blasphemous references.
According to the Talmud, Jesus was the product of adultery, the bastard son of Mary and a Roman soldier named Pantera. He spent his early life in Egypt, where he learned black magic, idolatry, and sorcery.
Jesus was born to a whore. Mary was a whore. She had sexual relations with many men. The father was a Roman centurion.
The Talmud further blasphemes the Lord Jesus by calling him a fool and comparing him with Old Testament villains such as Balaam, Ahithophel, Doeg, and Gehazi.
Does the Talmud talk about the Jews killing Jesus? Or
vaguely, but Maimonides believes that the Jews killed him, that the Jews executed him because of certain of his doctrines and so forth.
Do you believe that the Jews killed Jesus?
It's possible the Jews did kill Jesus.
Right.
So if, let's say they did. All right. Maybe he deserved to die. Maybe he was a troublemaker. Let's assume we did. Mm-hmm. So we killed somebody.
The Talmud actually gloats about Jesus dying young. The passage reads, "Hast thou heard how old Balaam was? He replied, bloody and deceitful men shall not live out half their days. It follows that he was 33 or 34 years old." And you say, wait, that passage says Balaam, not Jesus. But look at the footnote at the bottom of the page. Balaam is frequently used in the Talmud as a type of Jesus. Not only that, but in the Jewish Encyclopedia, Volume 2, page 469, under Balaam it says, Balaam given to Jesus in Sanhedrin 106b and Gittin 57a.
Peter Schaeffer states in his book, Jesus and the Talmud, that there can be no doubt that the narrative of the execution in the Talmud refers to Jesus. In fact, the book states, there is no reason to feel ashamed because we rightfully executed a blasphemer and idolater. Jesus deserved death, and he got what he deserved.
Gifts and the calling of God are irrevocable. Why am I sharing this with you today? Because over the years, many in the church have said that since the Jewish people rejected Jesus, they're no longer his chosen ones. But the scripture says that the gift and call of God is irrevocable.
Now, if anyone who doesn't know, a priest is a specific family clan of the nation of Israel who come from Aaron, the brother of Moses, who was the first priest. And anyone descended from Aaron has the status title priest. And we found that these men in this village in South Africa called Lemba, L-E-M-B-A, carry this genetic marker to let us know that they share the same as from the Sephardic and the Ashkenaz and the population of the people in Israel today, they share the same exact DNA marker. That's mind-blowing. So everyone kind of got humbled a little bit, who laughed at them and said, now what? Now what do we do about this? This could have tremendous implications. Another area in Africa you have something big happening is in Nigeria. You have the Igbo people, or Igbo, pronounced either way. There's 40 million of them, also Christians, like I spoke about before, how that could happen to the children of Israel very easily. But also a lot of them are now coming out and converting back or adopting the rules of the Torah without all the paganism that they've been practicing for hundreds of years. There's been books written about it from scholars in Nigeria, from scholars from the Jewish people. And where it gets interesting is, in America, there was a slave trade. And a lot of the slaves, a very high percentage of them, came from Western Nigerian ports. And in America today, you see a very large movement of African Americans who say that they're the real chosen people, that they're the children of Israel, they're the Judeans. You know, so what are they just trying to create an identity for themselves because they were slaves, or is there really something here? And the answer is most likely there is something there. And most likely, maybe that they were the original Israelites, and maybe that the Jewish people today who are white Caucasian people came in a little bit later on. We know that some of the greatest sages of the transmission of the Torah were converts from Rome. You have a man named Uncleus who wrote a commentary on the Torah, unprecedented, that we still learn today. He was a convert. Some of the largest pillars on the transmission today were Roman converts. So here we are, we're Caucasian Jewish people, and now you have people in Africa saying that they're the real people of Israel. It can't be ruled out at all. We know they were sold into slavery. We know now that they're fulfilling prophecies.